Hello there. A longer time ago, in a galaxy maybe far farther away than episodes 4, 5, and 6, George Lucas returned to do episodes 1, 2, and 3. So more recently, but in the actual Star Wars universe, a longer time ago. and they're not so good. But we're going to talk about the characters.
Yes. And this is podcasting.
And that, I'm sure, is not going to be the only time that we're going to do this in this podcast. Oh, man. Those bad Anakin lines.
Thankfully, we have a sponsor for today.
Let's introduce ourselves first, and then we'll get into the sponsor.
Okay. All right. That makes sense.
Welcome to Ignore the Bell. I'm Nathan.
I'm Tyler.
And I'm Luke.
Okay, and we do have a sponsor, right?
Yeah. So I was so excited to have been contacted by this sponsor. They heard that we were going to be doing this episode, and so I am very proud to have MaxiChlorian as our sponsor for the day. So when the midichlorians, you're just feeling a little low in the midichlorians. MaxiChlorian, available at all fine retail droids now. Ask your medical droid before.
This product is right for you. Sounds like it would be found in like the feminine hygiene aisle. What are you talking about?
Not midichlorians, it's MaxiChlorian.
This is gonna be the worst podcast. Enjoy.
Oh man, I wish this discussion could go on forever.
Ignore the bell. We're gonna keep going, people. Alright, so we are talking about the prequels, episodes 1, 2, and 3. Before, this is kind of a continuation of what we did with the original films, with episodes 4, 5, and 6, where we're really just looking at the characters. So it's not so much going to be about the themes or the overall execution, but just who are these characters, what's interesting about them. Now, before we get into that, Tyler, I do have a question for you. What are the side effects of MaxiChlorians?
One of the major side effects is having a bad feeling about things.
Oh, yes.
that definitely does come up. There is a very, very small risk, and I only mention this for, you know, the legal reasons. There is a potential for dying because you lost the will to live. That's
Oh.
Is there any problems with sand?
You will become extremely agitated by sand. It's coarse, it's grainy, it gets everywhere. Before I took MaxiChlorians, I had no problems with sand.
Also, magical virgin births. That's also a thing that that could happen.
That explains it.
Yes.
Spontaneous pregnancy. That's an issue.
Yes.
Are we going to try to do this in order of appearance, like what we did before with the original trilogy?
I mean, that makes sense in terms of keeping consistency, but it does not make any sense in regards to this film or these films.
I also think it's going to be a lot more difficult to remember who shows up first in the prequels.
Right.
Because after Qui-Gon and Obi-Wan, that's pretty much it. Like, after that, I'm not really sure.
Let's go into those two then. Qui-Gon Jinn is it's Liam Neeson, who is absolutely fantastic, and he's playing a character who doesn't really have much character. He's just kind of the stoic guy who's just always like, yes, the Force will work things out, which is good in some ways, but it's so much of a bland point of view. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, well, okay. I think this is part of the issue where people were so interested in seeing who are the Jedi. And that's what was so exciting about these prequel films, that it's like, we're actually going to get to see the Jedi Order. But what we already know about Jedi is that they're basically Vulcans, right? That they have disciplined themselves so well that they don't emote. They have emotions, but they've disciplined it where they're not just reacting, like they're not letting it out, whatever they happen to be feeling, that they are almost disassociating themselves from sentiment. So how interesting are characters going to be when that's the case?
Right.
Yeah.
Like,
And also, like, Qui-Gon is like, he goes like, I guess, against the Jedi code. So it's like kind of a interesting Jedi to begin with for the prequels, because like he does so many things that the Jedi don't want.
Yeah.
And like that's not really showing as much who the Jedi are as much as like they could have, I guess.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think, Nathan, you're right that, you know, how interesting can it be when Jedis don't emote? But at the same time, like, I feel like Obi-Wan in episode 4 had more character to him. I don't know, maybe not, but certainly Yoda did, right? Like, you get Yoda in episode 5, and he's playful, and, you know, I don't know, he's wacky, and he's so lovable.
He is, but he's not like that when he's on the Jedi Council in the prequels. Yeah. Right. And that it's like, because Yoda is, even though he's still a Jedi, he's not acting within the Jedi Order. And even when you get Obi-Wan in episode 4, then he's also not really acting in the Jedi Order. I mean, he's still carrying out this mission of protecting Luke, but, you know, and you do get to see him as a mentor to Luke. But at the same time, like, I do agree with you. I think that you get somehow more characterization in episode 4 than you get from most Jedi in the prequels.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So unless you guys have more to say about Qui-Gon, because I don't know how much there is to say about him.
I know. I feel like this is going to be short.
It's
interesting because there are... there's not a lot to say about most of these characters, but there are a lot of characters
that is true
who take center stage at one point or another. Anyway, so then we have Obi-Wan Kenobi, a young Obi-Wan Kenobi, and I mean, I love him. I love him in episode 1, certainly. And even in the rest of the prequel trilogy. I mean, there's a reason why people are really, really wanting Ewan McGregor to come back and for there to be, you know, some kind of additional story with Obi-Wan between episodes 3 and 4. Because he is, I don't know, he has this kind of charisma to him. Like, yeah, you can say that it is Ewan McGregor, but I think that it's something about Obi-Wan's personality. I mean, in episode 1, then he's very much, you know, like the Padawan, right? Like, he is the mentee. But he's, you know, he's hopeful. He's, I don't know, he's excited. And it's fun to, like, kind of be on that journey with him.
Mm, yeah, that is true. And he is, he's an interesting balance between a whole bunch of different types of Jedi that you get. Like, he's not too far in one direction. Like, if you were looking, like, if you're looking at Obi-Wan, especially within the prequels, and if you think about it in terms of, like, an RPG where you get to, like, choose all the different character traits, right? That it's, like, you can max out on one, but they don't have as many points left over for the other ones. He's just solidly, like, here. Right? You've got other Jedi who are maybe, you know, oh, they're more capable in this way, but then they have less of this, right? But he's just got such a good mix. He, you know, he's the kind of like car in Mario Kart or, you know, something like that, where it's like, he's not great for this one particular track, but he's well suited to almost everything. He'll always do okay. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. And it is actually explained as such by Anakin in one of the films, I forget which one, but he says, you know, like, oh, I love, you know, Master Kenobi. Like, he's, you know, he's as headstrong as Master Yoda and as strong with a lightsaber as Mace Windu. And he's just going like, whoa, those are like the two best of each of those fields. So maybe he's not quite as high as those two, but he is definitely a great balance. Yeah.
Luke, what do you think?
Yeah, I agree. The only thing that I didn't really like with Obi-Wan in the prequels wasn't, well, a lot of episode two, because in episode two, I felt like he was just, he was a lot more, I don't know what the word is here that I'm looking for, but he was just so, like, he seemed like he was always angry at Anakin for something, but and I felt like that took a lot away from the connection that him and Anakin have, which I didn't really like, because by the end of the movie, they didn't really feel like brothers or even that great of friends. It was just kind of like, because he was always criticizing Anakin for doing something when I felt like he should have been like, oh, okay, well, you know what, you did this, but at least, you know, you still got all these things going for you. So even though you might have thrown your lightsaber away while you were in this weird car chase thing, at least, like, you know, at least you were paying attention and, like, well, at least you were focused on what the main mission was. And then maybe give some more, like, constructive criticism almost, I guess. But yeah. I just felt like he did, like, I felt like too many times in the movie he was just too angry with Anakin.
Yeah, I would agree. I think a lot of that is Obi-Wan is he should be the main character of the prequel trilogy. He should be. he has the perfect arc from going from Padawan to you know, being the master, the mentor, and then becoming, you know, like partners with Anakin. So he has this really interesting journey in that he's playing a different role in each film. And I would agree that in episode two, then he doesn't quite know how to be a good mentor. Is there a word for the Jedi mentor? I can't remember, because I know that the mentee is the Padawan, but
well, just they usually just master. Use master. Yeah.
Okay.
But sorry, Tyler, you can finish your thought.
Yeah, no. So I think that, you know, like, a lot of that comes from, like, he didn't really, like, finish his training with Qui-Gon. Like, Qui-Gon said, like, oh, yeah, you know, Obi-Wan's definitely ready to be a Jedi master now. And the council was kind of like, I don't think so. And they said no. And then once Qui-Gon died, then they were like, okay, you know what, Obi-Wan, yeah, you can be a Jedi master, and all of a sudden you're going to be a mentor. And it's like, what?
Yeah.
Like a half hour earlier ago in the movie, you were like, oh no, he's not ready.
But so that does kind of fit, though, with episode, which one? Episode six? With Yoda, right, where Luke goes back and then he's like, I've got to complete my training, and it's like, oh yeah, the last part of your training was just coming back here to see me die, now you're ready,
right?
It's like, wait, what? Yeah. That was it? I had to, like, just visit you on your deathbed? So I like at least it's consistent where it's like, you're never going to be finished. You're not even close. You're done.
Yeah, it seems to be the Jedi way, like becoming a master seems to be, okay, did you confront a Sith? You did? Okay, cool. And you won the battle? You're a master. Like,
right.
That's all that's required. Like, oh, you didn't turn to the dark side when you faced off against somebody. Well done. You're a master. That's all that's necessary.
And I think you were totally right with that he was, like, not really ready to be a master. But the only problem that I think is that they didn't really, like, have a point in the end of the movie where he was like, okay, I now know what I'm doing and I've learned from my past mistakes and now I'm going to be... Because even at the end, when Anakin shows up to Geonosis and he's like, we've come to rescue you. And he's like, oh, wow, good job. And he's, as he's chained up, and it's like, you don't have to be that hard on him. He was trying to use the goodness of his heart to go out and save you from the villain. And you're just here like, oh, wow, well, your plan failed, so maybe next time you can have a better plan.
But I understand why. Like, I don't actually have an issue with why he's his character is doing what he's doing in episode 2. And I think it's supposed to be the motivation is that he is resentful about the fact that he has to train Anakin. That he didn't think that Anakin should have been taken on by Qui-Gon in the first place. That he thought that it was a bad idea, but he was too young for his wisdom to be respected, right? But we know that Obi-Wan is wise. And even at a young age, he's incredibly wise. So he's like, this is a mistake. You shouldn't do this. But then Qui-Gon takes him on. And even though the Jedi Council advises against this, and then Qui-Gon dies. So then by episode 2, then you see this, that it's like he has to take on this role as a mentor to Anakin. But he is so critical of Anakin because he's looking all the time for proof of his own bias against him, that he already believes that he's going to be too rash, that he's going to be too emotional, that he's, you know, he was too old to start the training, that he's got all of this bias against Anakin. And so every time Anakin does something that is maybe not the is maybe a little bit foolish or at least not wise, then it's like, there's the proof. This is why I don't think we should have taken him on, but there's nothing he can do. I feel like that's kind of like coming back to this grief that he has that can't get fully expressed for Qui-Gon, because he can't go to Qui-Gon and say, this is your fault. Like, you know, because I don't even know how much it is that he's angry with Anakin in episode 2. I feel like there's that anger and resentment towards Qui-Gon, but there's no one there to grab. There's no one there to grab by the shoulders and to shake and to say, you know, that it's not Anakin's fault because he was too old, but that's not his fault. He wasn't the one who decided to become, mm-hmm. to start getting trained. I think that's at least what the intent was with episode 2 of this character.
Yeah, I would agree. I think, honestly, belated media's, what if episode 1, 2, and 3 were good? He does such a good job of, you know, reimagining the prequel trilogy as Obi-Wan's story. And he does include, like, this moment where instead of, you know, Obi-Wan and Qui-Gon being inside the Jedi Council when Qui-Gon asks, oh yeah, I want to take on Anakin as my Padawan. Instead, then Obi-Wan and Anakin are outside the Council, and Obi-Wan knows what's going on in there, and he, you know, is kind of resentful and distant and whatever toward Anakin in that moment. So you get a lot of that setup in advance of him being, you know, angrier with with both Qui-Gon and with Anakin,
which to me ends up like, because if you read it the way I think it should be read in episode 2, where there's all this hostility and resentment that he's holding, that when you end up in episode 3, where he sees that Anakin has turned to the dark side, and, you know, he's confronting him on, you know, the edge of, like, the volcano thing, and he, and I think it's actually the best moment of the prequels, where he is just devastated, and he, for a Jedi who has been in such control of his emotions, that you just see that he can't control his emotions there, and he just accuses him, you were the chosen one. Right. And it's like, that's where it's coming from. It's just, it's that looking back at Qui-Gon and then saying, like, you believed this, and it did hold up with all of the prophecy. So I reluctantly trained you. And now that betrayal is even worse, because I didn't really want to be a part of this, but I did it because I was going along with what Qui-Gon wanted. Right. And that he feels like it didn't work. That it's just, there's a lot of complexity to what he's feeling there.
Yeah. No, he is absolutely, you know, he's disappointed in Anakin because Anakin is letting down him. He's letting down the Jedi Council. He's letting down Padme, and he's letting down Qui-Gon, who is, you know, Obi-Wan's master. Like, he's, Obi-Wan is, you know, very thrown off and, you know, disheartened by everything there. Like, he, and like, Ewan McGregor is a fantastic actor and does convey a lot of that emotion in that whole sequence. So I think you're absolutely right there.
Yeah, because it's like when he's saying it, that you were the chosen one, and you can see that he's so distraught by saying this. It's that, even though, like, it helps make episode 2 better, because when you're looking at it, you're saying he was resentful of Anakin being trained, but he didn't really believe that it would ever go to that. He was just like, he's just not going to be, he might not be a great Jedi, or he might have some colossal mistake or something like that because of his arrogance, or because he lets his emotions take over. But he never thought, you know, you're going to betray all of us and you know, have all of us get killed. So it's like, you see that resentment, and it's like, well, I didn't really believe in you, but I didn't think that it was this, right? There was already a little bit of hostility there and resentment, but it's that it's so much worse than he ever even could have imagined or foreseen. Do you guys agree with me that's maybe the best scene in the entire, like, prequels, at least as far as drama?
I mean, I think that episode 3 in general is the best out of the prequels. And yeah, like, that basically the whole confrontation between Obi-Wan and Anakin is the heart, the all the drama of the trilogy is right there in that one sequence. You know, I mean, there's a little bit of, you know, fancy lightsabering that interrupts it now and then, but there is still that drama that is conveyed, especially by Ewan McGregor. And yeah, best sequence in terms of drama, for sure.
Yeah, the only other one that I think would come as close, like, would come pretty close, would be when Anakin's going to kill the Tusken Raiders. But the only problem with that is that they cut it off too early, I think. And that's why I think that that's not as emotional as it could have been, or as good as it could have been. But I think it could have been, like, really close.
You know, that reminds me that, like, we talked about Qui-Gon being in episode 1, but I mean, he really is in episode 2 and 3 as well, in some small way. You have his voice, you know, him as a Force ghost, basically, trying to talk to Anakin, trying to bring him back from the dark road that he's set out on. And that, I think, is really, really interesting, because Obi-Wan is as far as the films are concerned, and certainly Yoda makes this seem to be the case, Qui-Gon was the first one to become one with the Force and go beyond death, which is fascinating because, like, when you're watching episodes 4, 5, and 6, you're just kind of thinking, oh yeah, I guess Jedi just become one with the Force when they die. But apparently, like, that wasn't a thing before. So it's really, really crazy that, you know, Qui-Gon does that. Yoda's able to tell, like, hey, wait a second, you're still here, you're still around me, and then tells Obi-Wan that Obi-Wan can continue training with Qui-Gon between episodes 3 and 4. And obviously Qui-Gon can sort of show Obi-Wan and Yoda the way to becoming a Force ghost. As to how Anakin discovered that, I'm not sure.
Yeah,
episode 6, that's where it kind of falls apart.
Yeah,
that's an important moment for different reasons. So maybe you could say, like, Qui-Gon helped Anakin to reach that state. I don't know.
Yeah.
Well, like, they show in the Clone Wars animated series in season 6, they show Yoda learning from Qui-Gon how to become a Force ghost or whatever. And it's one of the most interesting story arcs, in my opinion. But, like, so they show that. But yeah, I've always been like, but how does Anakin? Because, like, we watch in the Clone Wars how Yoda becomes, like, how he's able to become a Force ghost. But, and it's like, you can see that maybe Obi-Wan would have been able to. It's a really weird thing, though, because, like, Yoda goes to, like, this planet, or he gets, like, almost, like, tractor-beamed into it. It's really weird, and it's almost hard to see Obi-Wan going through all of the things that Yoda does in those episodes, but, like, it's just, yeah, sometimes I'm just like, the continuity here is not quite lining up, but that's just...
Yeah. there does come to be a point where you just have to go, like, I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know how it works, but somehow it does.
Right. Yeah. Well, that's the problem. Like, when you start getting into this very didactic kind of storytelling, right? That it's like, you know, where it's basically an assembly pamphlet of, like, step one, step two, step three. Yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah. Attach this to that. Like, when you start getting into that kind of storytelling of, here's exactly how it works. Then the problem is, you're like, okay, but you miss something between steps 3 and 4, right?
Yeah.
And it's like, it usually doesn't lend itself to very good storytelling.
Yeah.
I think that's really funny that you said between steps 3 and 4.
Yes. There you go. Yes. That's where the problems are.
That's for sure.
All right. So who's our next character?
I guess the Trade Federation guys.
Oh, yeah. Like, what can you say about them? Oh, I don't want this blockade. Oh, but it's there.
Why are we working with Darth Sidious? I don't know.
Beats me. Yeah.
I don't like this at all. Then why do you keep doing it?
Yeah. Great character. So some of the best I've ever seen.
Yes. So then they speak to Darth Sidious on the holographic projector communicator thing, which is funny because that doesn't come up, like, at all in episodes 4, 5, and 6. I guess that technology was somehow lost. They never communicate that way in 4, 5, and 6, right? Oh, I guess the Emperor does.
Yeah.
Yeah, he does. They were like that.
Yeah.
But it is that. Weird because like everybody seems to be doing it in episode three. Like
I know,
nothing.
Well, that's what I was gonna bring up at the beginning of the podcast in the introductions. It's just like a longer time ago, but somehow with better technology.
Yeah,
right. Like that's the confusing thing.
Yeah,
yeah. But anyway, Darth Sidious. Yeah, Palpatine. He is. Possibly the I would probably say the second most interesting character in the prequel trilogy, right behind Obi-Wan. Yes, he's more
I thought it was the guy from the Dos Equis commercials. The most interesting man.
Yeah, so he is very interesting.
Yeah. So I mean, I don't know if we should just jump right into to what I was mentioning to you before, Tyler, with this about his role in the prequels. Do you want me to get into that?
Yeah, go right ahead.
So I think that you can make the argument, because we were talking before we started recording about who is the protagonist, like who's the main, who are the main characters in the prequels, and certainly who is the hero or the protagonist. And I think that it's definitely Qui-Gon in The Phantom Menace, but then in episodes 2 and 3, then I think you can make a very strong argument that it's really Palpatine, that it's they're his films and it's his story. And because like, if you understand what a protagonist is, a protagonist is a character who is trying to accomplish something, a character who's trying to get something done. And then the antagonist is the character who is standing in their way. And so it's typically that we're following along with that protagonist who is typically proactively trying to do something. And then you've got, you know, the villains are the ones who are trying to stop them from doing this. So I think if you're looking at, let's say, something like The Dark Knight, then you could argue that it's actually the Joker who is the protagonist of that film, and Batman is very much the antagonist. Batman is reacting all the time, and he doesn't really seem to have much of a plan, but the Joker, for all of his talk that he has no plan, he definitely has a plan, and he is getting things done. And so I think that and another way of viewing it, and even though John Milton would absolutely hate this reading, but John Milton's epic poem, Paradise Lost, which takes the first few books of Genesis, the first few chapters, not books, first few chapters of Genesis, and then he like blows it up into like a 300 page poem, then it's really about all the backstory between God and then Lucifer, who ends up becoming Satan. And you can look through that and you can say, well, in Paradise Lost, and it, like, I'm not the one who's come up with this, this is a very important and famous interpretation of it. It's that Satan is actually the hero or the protagonist of Paradise Lost, because he's the one who is actively getting things done, and we're really following him along as he gets things done, and God is kind of reacting and standing in the way of that. So I don't know what you guys think about that, that the films, episodes 2 and 3, are really Palpatine's films.
Yeah, I agree with that pretty much completely, because,
I mean, even in episode 1, then he is very much the character who is trying to achieve something. He is trying to create a clone army. He is trying to, you know, he creates this whole separatist movement. He's trying to divide the galaxy so that he can unite it under his iron fist. I think you're absolutely right. And honestly, like, I haven't heard anybody else posit that. Like, that it's a really fascinating interpretation, because he really is, you know, the one who is constantly plotting and, you know, to use a less connotative word, like, just he's very he's planning, right? Like, he's just he's creating all these plans that are just okay, you know, yeah, I'm gonna have this person who's gonna make it, like, I'm gonna have Darth Maul who's going to make the existence of the Sith known, which is only going to intensify the you know, the fear that the Jedi Council and the Jedi Order is not the saviors that everybody in the galaxy thinks that they are.
Yeah. And here's how I am arguing that he's the protagonist. Really, like, you can take any, like, hero and villain and then say, well, the villain's always trying to accomplish something, and so is the hero. But the way you know who is your hero and who is your villain, or who is your protagonist and who's your antagonist, is, okay, but who is this story about? Like, how are you telling this story? And if you watch the prequels, then we, the viewer, are privy to stuff. We get this dramatic irony where we are privy to stuff that people within the film are not privy to. And that, look at how many scenes that have Palpatine, the camera lingers on him for an extra second or two, and then he smirks. Right? Where you see this, like, again and again and again. And it's this little, like, he's not doing it directly to the viewer. Like, he's not breaking the fourth wall, but you get to see that we are following him. We are in on his plans. Yeah. And that's where I'm saying that the films are about him. And this is, I'm not trying to redirect the conversation, because I want to restrict ourselves to the prequels, but that's really, like, my issue. And I know I'm really I hesitate to do this, but with episode 8, that's part of my issue, is that who are the protagonists within episode 8? Because it's certainly not the resistance, because they don't have a plan. like even if they have a plan, how are they our protagonists if we don't get to know what the plan is? Because in the original films, in episodes 4, 5, and 6, then it's like, yes, you do have the Empire that's built this Death Star, and their plan is to rule the galaxy with it and to show its power. But we're not really following them. We're really following the rebels, who have a plan. We've stolen the plans to the Death Star. We know the weakness of it. Our plan is to go in there with smaller X-Wing fighters to then go into this little, like, channel to be able to then shoot into it and then explode it. So it's like, oh, that's who we're following. They both have plans, but we're following this group. But I'm saying in episode 8, it's like, we, the viewers, are denied the plan.
Yeah.
And that's where I say, like, that's my issue with it. It's just like, how are we supposed to treat you as the heroes of this film if we don't even get to be a part of it?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, in the prequels, then we're not fully aware of what Palpatine's plans are, but we are more aware that there is a plan, and that you know, it has something to do with you know, the fall of the Jedi Order.
Yeah, that he's working towards something. He's building it. He is a chess player who is moving these pieces around, and we don't quite know how exactly it's going to play out, but we know that, like, we're our eyes are trained on him the whole time.
Yeah. It's interesting, because I know that, like, the first time that I watched the prequels, like, certainly episodes 1 and 2, I was not fully aware that, I mean, I was, you know, pretty young, but I wasn't really aware that Palpatine became the Emperor. Like, I didn't make the connection between the two. Because, I mean, the Emperor in episodes 4, 5, and 6 is never referred to as Palpatine. He's always just referred to as the Emperor. And I mean, like, his first name is actually never said in any of the films, which I believe is, like, Sheev?
Yeah.
That's a weird name.
So is pretty much every name in Star Wars, though.
Yeah.
That's true. Yeah. But, yeah, so... So it's something that I, you know, I wasn't fully, you know, invested in, like, watching what Palpatine was doing the first time that I watched it. But certainly, you know, upon repeat viewings, and he's the one that I'm watching.
Right. It was when I first watched that I noticed that, like, the camera kept lingering on him. And it wasn't doing this with other characters. So I'm going, oh, well, you're telling me that there's something up with this guy. And that was the signal. Yeah. Luke, what do you think?
I think you're totally right. And I think that it's really interesting, because we don't, like, the Jedi definitely don't have a plan in it in the prequels, like, at all. All we know is that they're looking for the Dark Lord of the Sith, and that's it.
Yep.
Like,
I mean, that's not even their plan at the beginning. Like, at the beginning, then they're just like, let's keep the peace.
Yeah.
Okay, great. That makes for a compelling story.
There you go. One guy who's like, can I train this boy? And then they're like, no.
Yeah. That's pretty
that's basically it.
Yeah. So I totally agree with Palpatine being the main character or protagonist of episodes 2 and 3 for sure. And episode 1 slightly more of like a background one, not as main of a character, but definitely in the background. But with episode 1, there's also like he has more of a plan than still pretty much anyone in the movie, other than like Qui-Gon's really his only plan is to like get Anakin to be trained as a Jedi. I mean,
yeah.
That's pretty much it.
And that seems to be mostly what episode 1 is about.
Yeah.
That's why I'm saying that I think he's the protagonist there, because he is the character that we are following as he tries to accomplish something. And then, of course, he dies, so then, like, well, you're not following him anymore, so now who are we following? And I think we end up following Palpatine, even though I think the intention was that we were supposed to be following Anakin, but... like, what exactly were we supposed to be following? Like, you know, like, woo, teenage love. right? Yeah.
No.
One's a teenager.
Good point. Good point. If that was reversed, it would just be like, you know, this film is despicable. It's such a double standard. You know what I mean?
It's true.
Like, everything about that, like, when he, like, meets her and he's a little kid and she's like, you're a funny little boy. And it's like, if there was a dude who's, like, in his 20s and it's like, meets, like, a 9-year-old girl and it's like, you're a funny little girl. And then they end up in a relationship not that many years later, you're like,
it's an odd choice that George Lucas made, to say the least.
It's an odd choice.
like why did Padme have to be that old? Why did, like, she's not like in her 20s. She, I think, like, at the time that they filmed it, then she was like, I don't know, like 13, like 12 or 13 or something. But she was like, yeah, like she was actually pretty young. Like, you can tell that, like, she's not as tall as she became in the other films. But it still looks really odd, because Natalie Portman is much more developed than little orphan Annie. Okay, so we have more characters to get to.
Who's next?
And we will talk more about Anakin, of course. I think the next character that appears is everybody's favorite, right? Yeah. Jar Jar Binks.
Okay. Sorry, I'm distracted. I'm trying to find, like, how old Natalie Portman was when she did it. But yes, if that's okay,
because they go down to Naboo, and then they meet Jar Jar Binks.
So is that our next character then?
I think so. Who wants to be the first to say something about?
All right. I'm just gonna say it. I think that most people who have got such... I think Jar Jar Binks is... people have overreacted so much to him as a character, and it's so ridiculous, because it's like, as if there were not already silly characters within Star Wars before this. And I don't understand why there can't be a character within Star Wars. I mean, like, this is not like... Othello that is being put on, and then you've got a character who comes out and, like, drops his pants and, like, gets, like, a, you know, banana cream pie in the face. Like, we're talking about Star Wars, where you've got weird alien creatures, because you're dealing with this galaxy, and it's like, I understand that it's like he's too cartoonish for some people, and I think that's the criticism. It's, but I've understood that people have been upset, but I've never really understood why they've been so upset by Jar Jar Binks.
Yeah, I would agree. I think that as a character, he is one of the more developed characters.
He is.
He really is. Like, he has this whole backstory of, like, oh, well, he's clumsy, and so then he gets kicked out of, you know, his, like, community and everything, and everybody looks down on him, and then he becomes this ambassador for the Gungans to the rest of the people of the Naboo. So it's like, oh, well, that's actually a really interesting story to follow. And yeah, like, he's a little, you know, dim-witted at times, but I mean, he is pure slapstick. But I don't think that that's necessarily bad. He is fine, and he does have an interesting arc where he becomes more a more important figure, even though his role is lessened, or his screen time is lessened, but his role is increased, where, you know, he's the one who grants emergency powers to the Chancellor, which, you know, I mean, you can hate on Jar Jar all you want for doing that. Like, it totally made sense. And Darth Sidious was playing everybody at that point.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know.
Yeah, I think that the problem that people have is it's like, it's similar to how I feel about the new comedy and 7 and 8.
Yeah.
Because I think people are like I still like Poe Dameron and Finn as characters, but then there's just times with Poe, when he's like, so who talks first? You talk first, I talk first. Where it's just like, oh, well, that kind of took me out of Star Wars for a second. And I think that it's the same for Jar Jar, is that, like, it's not necessarily that he's a bad character. It's just that, like you're just watching them all walk through the streets of Tatooine, and then he just steps on poop and, like, starts to wipe it off. It's like, why did that, like, why was that necessary? And I think that's the problem that people have. Because I think you guys are right that he does have a good amount of character development, and it's not that he's a bad character. I think there's just some lines and some things that he does that were just like, does that really need to be in a Star Wars movie? And I think it just takes people out of Star Wars.
Yeah, I think you're right. But I think that's an issue of a director, right? Not just like a screenwriter, but also, you know, the choices of a director and then the editor and all of that. Yeah. But to me, like, because people, like, I guess my point is, if you're going to really be trying to have a fully immersive universe, then you're going to get all kinds of different characters. I mean, you look in our world, and even in war, there are going to be some soldiers who cannot help themselves. They make jokes.
Right.
Yeah. Like, that you've got some silly people who have a heart, or who just, even they're not trying to be funny, but they just end up being funny. Like, you've got some, you know, fairly like goofy people who are clumsy. And but I think it's really just, okay, but we didn't need to have that on screen because it ultimately changes the tone of the film. And I think that's a really fair criticism. But then when all that criticism has been landed, like, it, people lay it on the feet of Jar Jar Binks as if he ruined Star Wars as a character, and that it's like, we can't have him in these films. And it's like, well, you could have him. You just maybe don't need to show all of the silly things that all of the silly hijinks he gets himself into, you know?
Yeah.
I think that one perfect example is, like, when they're sitting around the table in Shmi Skywalker's house, and Jar Jar is, you know, using his tongue to, like, grab apples or whatever fruit they were. And then at the one point, then Qui-Gon grabs his tongue and he says, don't do that again. That gives me the sense of, like, oh, yeah, there are different cultures, and Jar Jar's culture doesn't know what the rules are, what the etiquette is of these other cultures. And that's actually really interesting. Then you get a moment where, you know, Jar Jar like drops a wrench and then his tongue ends up in the middle of the power coupling thing of the pod racer. And then you're watching him be like, my tongue is numb for like 3 minutes. And you're like, okay, well, I didn't need that.
Yeah.
that didn't really add anything. So there are like the different moments. And I mean, again, like that moment isn't horrible, but I think that it's just, it's unnecessary and it feels unnecessary.
I have a question for you guys, but Luke, I feel like you've been trying to get in here, so you can go first.
Well, I was pretty much going to make the same point that Tyler just made, because like, even with the Ewoks and Return of the Jedi, it's like they do things that are like silly or things that just kind of seem campy, and they don't like break the tone of the original trilogy though. But Jar Jar does break the tone of the prequels. And so I think like, cause when you see like the Ewok and he's like poking Leia with like the spear and all that, or he's like gets afraid because he hears a noise, like it's kind of like you almost wonder like, was that necessary? But then you realize that like it's because of their character that they're doing that. But then it's like Jar Jar, like I get that they're trying to show that he's like clumsy when he hits his tongue on the power coupling and his tongue goes numb and all that, but like I think that that wasn't as like necessary, because like with the Ewoks we're getting to see their culture through one character, but with Jar Jar it's not like we're seeing that, we're just seeing how he is, I guess, but in a more drawn out way.
Yeah, I think you bring up a really interesting point in that like the Ewoks sort of they alleviate some of the tension that's built up by the time you get to episode 6. But when you go into episode 1, then it's like, well, we don't have any tension yet. So
I think that's it.
Yeah. Having that comedic of a character, then it's just like, well, I can't even get invested in, you know, what's going on, because there's just all these jokes that keep interrupting things where it's like, I want to know what is the drama here? And we don't have time to get into that.
That's exactly it, because this brings up the question that I have, because, and again, that comes back to direction, right? Mm-hmm. Of knowing when or if to include that scene or sequence within the film, right?
Yeah.
That my question would be, what's the difference between some of the stuff that Jar Jar Binks does and some of the stuff that you see C-3PO do in episodes 4, 5, and 6? Like, for instance, like, what is the difference between all the stuff that Jar Jar does and then C-3PO when he gets blasted into all these different pieces and then Chewie puts them back together, but then his head's on backwards, and then it's like they're running down like the, you know, corridors of, I forget where they are, but they're on like an Empire
Cloud City.
Oh, okay, Cloud City, yeah. And it's like, and he's in all these different pieces, and he's like, ah, right? Like, what is the difference between that and Jar Jar Binks?
Even when Chewie's like turning 3PO back on, it's like, no, don't get up. What? The Empire is here? Oh, no, I've been shot. And you're just like, dying of laughter.
Yes.
In the midst of the sequence.
Exactly. So that my point is, and Tyler, what you're saying, I think that explains it, is, well, if you already have tension, then that comedy can work to break the tension. And I think, Luke, what you talk about with, you know, with Poe, for instance, is that you've got at the very beginning of episode 8, then you get this comedy routine, this like, it's supposedly like witty banter between them, you know, but it's like, but there's no tension that you're breaking. We just started.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But that's direction. That, to me, is not character. So then people, but I think a lot of people, and maybe it's just as simple as people don't know that.
Right?
Yeah.
They can't put their finger on exactly what it is that they don't like about Jar Jar.
Yeah.
But they're just like, Jar Jar is too funny for Star Wars. And it's like, well, but that's not the issue. It's not that he's funny. It's the way that he's included. It's the direction around his character.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, it's that's really interesting. This is such a fun discussion.
Yeah.
This is like that's probably like one of the most unpopular opinions on the internet that all three of us agreed on.
Yeah, well, I think that we've seen changes happen with the way we talk about films since we now have so many people, basically since YouTube, and you know, Twitter as well, and social media in general. But it's that episode one comes out, and yeah, you have the internet, but you don't really have people who are having conversations like this who can then outline what are the issues with this, because you definitely have that with, you know, The Force Awakens or The Last Jedi, where you have all of these very prominent commentators who spend a long time thinking about what the issues are with these films, and then they break it down, and then people either agree or disagree, but then it's fairly well articulated. But in 1999, this isn't being fairly well articulated on online, where everybody can go and get that content from the same source. So instead, everybody's just kind of grumbling in general, but the complaints end up not making a lot of sense, because that's my issue, is I just hear them and I'm like, but those complaints don't make sense. I hear the complaints about the comedy in, you know, newer Star Wars films, and I totally get it, because people have taken a fair bit of time explaining exactly what the issues are with the comedy in the film, but they don't say, well, the issue is Huck, or the issue is Poe, or, you know what I mean? Like, they're like, here's why this comedy doesn't work in Star Wars.
Right.
Yeah.
Cool. Jar Jar Binks we covered. Who's next?
Is it Darth Maul or
is no, it? I think it might be Padme. Technically, it's Queen Amidala's double.
Oh yeah.
Because it's not actually Padme. It's somebody in the like who's playing Padme while Padme is off to the side. But yeah, like let's I guess just do Padme then.
Sure.
Cool. Sorry, that was a confusing way to get there.
No, it's so confusing, and that's why I paused, because I'm like, do we talk about that? Because I don't even understand. I get the fact that, you know, famous people will have body doubles and whatever, but it just seemed like, did you think that you were making like a murder mystery, like this whole, you know, like reveal, like ha ha ha, it was me all along? Why was that in there?
I think honestly, it's, you know, George Lucas was like, people absolutely loved episode 5, and I had that big reveal at the end. Let's put reveals in all my films.
Maybe that's what it's supposed to be. It's like, that's the same, right? Darth Vader actually being Luke's father. And it's like, yeah, you thought that she was me, but that's actually me, queen over here. Once you guys were disrespecting, but not at all. Like, I...
Yeah, and I think that, like, it almost seemed like they wanted you to feel something, like, really sad when she dies in episode 2. And she's, like, she's talking to Padme, and it... Like, Padme is, like, pretty much crying because this person died when it should have been her. But, like, we don't know this person at all. So, no, like, we don't have any title. Is that even
the same body double? I don't know.
Yeah, like, that's a good point.
That's the problem with clones.
Well, we'll get to the clones.
Right. But, yeah, I don't know what to... Okay. But, yeah, okay. So, Padme Amidala. I don't know, episodes 1, 2, and 3. Thoughts?
She is, you know, she's queen in the first film, but they elect their queens, which I don't really get.
It's kind of not how monarchy works.
Right. I'm like, I don't understand. It felt like George Lucas was like, oh yeah, see, she's the queen, which totally is why it's Princess Leia.
Princess Leia.
Wait. No, that's not, we don't need that connection. And also, Padme can't be running around to different planets in episodes 2 and 3. She's still queen. So they just elected a different queen.
Right.
It also seemed like...
get it. What happened?
It also seemed like they were trying to make her almost like really similar to Anakin, because she in episode 2, she's like, I'm the youngest queen to ever be elected as the queen. And then Anakin is like, it's going to be the most powerful or whatever. So it's like, it almost seems like they're both like the best. And so it's like, I don't really like, it didn't come off that way though. It just seemed like almost like a throwaway line when she's like, I'm the youngest queen to ever be elected. And well, it's like,
there's so much that's just shallow within the prequels where it's just, there's not actually a lot of depth or complexity, but there is an attempt towards it.
Yeah.
I feel like, and I'm not trying, I hesitate to do this, but I'm not trying to make a feminist point here, because I don't think it actually really makes sense to do this. But basically, she is not a very well-developed character, and she's certainly just reacting all the time to different things. There doesn't seem to be much to her. But the reason why I'm saying I hesitate to make the feminist critique of the film is that it's like, but there's so many characters, regardless of gender, who are in the exact same position, and even different species and all of that, where it's like, it's not because she's a woman. It's, you know, because there's just a whole bunch of them that are in this position of, you know, you're a functional character, you know, just stand there and then let me like bounce all of these lines of dialogue off of you and just kind of react.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's actually something I was going to bring up is like, okay, so she's the queen and yet she is not, she's pretending to be the maidservant in all of episode 1. Which means that she's cleaning R2-D2 and all that and going off with Qui-Gon into the city, you know, on Tatooine, and doing all these dangerous things. Like, she's putting herself in more danger by not being the queen than I don't know, she's doing like menial work and not being involved in these conversations that are quite important. Because she's just like off to the side. I don't quite understand how, like, I don't know. It feels like George Lucas really, really changed his mind about who he wanted Padme to be after episode 1, because in episodes, oh my goodness, wow, I can't believe that's been an hour already. In episodes 2 and 3, then Padme is, well, certainly in episode 2, then she's much more of a fighter. I mean, you kind of see it at the end of episode 1, but like in episode 2, then she's like, yeah, let's go fighting. And it's just like, oh, okay, cool. You're totally up for this. That sounds fantastic. And then in episode 3, she's just pregnant for the entire film. Yep. Like, that's her character in episode 3. Yeah. It's just, she's the pregnant woman.
Right.
And how weird is it?
It's just so functional.
Yeah, she really is like, she's just the love interest. So she is fulfilling whatever role she needs to in each film.
Exactly.
Which is so weird, because in episode 2, then she's, you know, the one who's like, okay, yeah, let's go fight. And Anakin's like, okay, yeah, let's go fight. In episode 3, then she's like, okay, let's settle down. And he's like, oh, I got to find a way to protect my wife. And so it's so weird that we are introduced to the love interest before we're introduced to, you know, the character of Anakin. Like, how weird is that?
That's a good point. I think that Anakin has like such a almost like a different point of view in episode 2 than she does, because she's like, she really just doesn't care to be put in danger and all that. But Anakin's like, well, no, like, it's kind of my job to protect you. But I think it could have been done better if there was more chemistry between them. Like, c- because they kind of just say something and then they don't really talk about it. And that, like, because when Padme is like, oh, I was the youngest queen to ever be elected, then Anakin could be like, oh my goodness, I know how much stress there is. And he could maybe be like, I was the youngest Padawan to, like, Jedi to ever become a Padawan. And then he could be like, so, like, it's so stressful because you have, I know, but like, I think that it would have been better to say that.
That was like their main critique of him.
Anyway. Yeah. But I think, like, you could have been like, they could have been like, oh, but he's so strong. Cause, like, he does end up being, like, the youngest person to ever be on the Jedi Council in episode 3. And so I think if you did something similar with that in episode 2, then it would end up working out better. And then they could have something to, like, connect about, which, because they don't really have anything to talk about. Like, they don't share almost any similarities, because Anakin hates sand, Padme loves sand, and it's a small thing.
Opposites attract.
I suppose, but extreme opposites in this case.
Yeah, I mean, Nathan, like, you brought it up before, where, like, everything is so shallow, and, like, Anakin is interested in Padme because of the way she looks. Like, are you an angel? I heard that they're the most beautiful creatures in the galaxy. And it's like, oh, okay, so he likes the way that she looks. And then, like, whatever, like, 10 years later, or whatever it is, when episode 2 happens, and all of a sudden, then he's like, oh, man, I've been waiting to see this girl that I had a crush on when I was 10 years old for all these years. And then he sees her, and he's all creepy and, I don't know, okay, like, obsessed with her over nothing. Like, well, they did not do anything.
Let me try to do a real reading of this, okay? But it's so creepy. All right? So, if this was a piece of literature or a serious film, then this is the reading that would come out of it. Tyler, Natalie Portman was born in 1981. Star Wars came out, we're talking about 1999. And so even with film, so 18 when the film was released, but let's say 17 when it was being filmed. Okay.
Yeah.
And then the actor, what's it? Lloyd, what's his?
Jake Lloyd. Christopher Lloyd is Doc Brown. And,
young Anakin Skywalker.
So Jake Lloyd was born in 89. So there's an 8-year difference. So I was I said like 20s, or I don't know if I said late teens, but 20s, right? So, like, basically a 17-year-old and a 9-year-old. Okay. Yeah. Now he gets separated from his mother, and she brings up all this stuff in episode 1. You miss your mother, right? I miss my mother. And then it's like, so you get the separation of the mother, and then you have this much older woman who is caring for you and actually wants to protect you, and then you still want your mother, but then you meet her later on in life. That this is super creepy, because this is very Oedipal, right? Yeah, that absolutely. She's a substitute for his mother. Like, you can do a psychoanalytical reading of this, and it comes out to that. It's this Oedipal complex that he's got, where he substituted his mother with her, and it's like, ugh, those are your parents, Leia and Luke. That's how they met.
Yeah. No, it is super creepy. It's, I mean, I'm not denying that it is weird in episode 1. Like, the age difference is definitely there, and having heard, like, oh my goodness, 8-year difference is far too much for I mean, for most relationships, but certainly if you're talking about a 9-year-old boy, like, oh my goodness,
that's what I'm saying. And especially if I think that this got overlooked, and I think it still kind of gets overlooked because of the genders. Because if the genders were reversed, if it was a 17-year-old dude who was paying a lot of attention to a 9-year-old girl, like, this film would not get released.
That's true. Yeah. Now I'm imagining, you know, some teenage guy with, like, some, you know, peach fuzz, who's like looking at, you know, a young Padme going, are you an angel?
Right. Yeah. Or watch this line of dialogue. You miss your daddy, don't you? Like, no, you can't do that. This is terrible. It's despicable, right? But that double standard that we have.
Yeah.
Do we have anything more to say about Amidala Padme?
Not really.
Yeah.
She really is just the object of Anakin's affection. That about sums up her character, honestly.
Yeah, and you were saying how, the way she reveals herself as the queen in episode one is kind of weird, because, like, they're talking with the Gungans and all that, and the person who's pretending to be the queen is, like, speaking for all of the rest of Naboo and stuff, but she's not even the queen, like, and then right. Padme is like, oh, yeah, I'm the queen, and it's like, but she just gave, like, this speech about, like, Naboo and stuff, and you just kind of sat there listening to this, and you didn't even take control and be like, I'm the queen, I speak for Naboo, like.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The only, like, earlier in the filming, you do get a little bit of a moment where the queen asks Padme, like, what do you think? And then Padme doesn't even really say anything. She just says, we're your loyal servants and we'll go where you wish. Like, that's what she says.
Right.
It's like, oh, okay.
Maybe she's trying to hint to the other servants and be like, yeah, go where I tell you to go. And then just do what I tell you to do.
Yeah.
It's just like, that didn't answer the question of should we land on Tatooine or not? It was just like, okay, cool. Yeah, you're going to go wherever the non-queen decides that you're going to go. Like, this makes no sense.
That's what I'm saying. That whole element just seems so dumb to me. I think it was you, Tyler, who said, you know, because you get these reveals, like, in episode 5. Is it you who said that, or was that Luke?
That was me. Yeah.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think that's what it was supposed to be. It was like, ah-ha-ha! It was me all along! And we're supposed to be, like, you know, in the position of Luke, like, no! It can't be! Search your heart! You knew that I was queen all along!
Just go back to that one scene where the queen asks her a question and she says something completely nonsensical. It's the hints were there.
The only hint is, like, when she's like, she says to Qui-Gon, you know, something like, you know, the queen would not approve. And he's like, well, the queen's not here. And she's like, well, I don't approve. And it's like, but that was as tough as she ever got to be.
Yeah.
It's like, if she was actually a strong character, like a strong personality, she would have asserted herself there, but she's just like, well, I don't approve, but I am the queen. I just can't say it.
Yeah,
like, who's next?
R2-D2.
Okay. A young R2-D2.
Right, yes.
And
he's
in a way
shiny and new.
Yeah. He's technically different from the one. Oh, wait, no, he's the same. It's C-3PO who's different, technically, in these movies, even though he doesn't really, because his mind is wiped in episode 3, but, like, he doesn't really change.
Right, yeah. Yeah, no, R2-D2 is a standard astromech droid who is the only one left after trying to fix the ship's shield generator. And then they proceeded to take him everywhere with them.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yep.
Because he was the lucky one that just happened not to get shot.
That's right.
Literally just luck. Like, oh man, this is a very well put together droid. Like, what? It's not like dodged out of the way of any other blaster fire.
Right. Okay, I've got a question for you, though, because this is actually a very serious Star Wars question. The way the role that he plays within these films, it sure seems like R2-D2 has got the Force. And I mean that quite seriously. I think that you can see that, like, why does the Force have to be cut off, or why would droids be cut off from the Force? Because it sure seems that R2-D2 actually is tuned into the Force. The things, he's not just getting lucky and then lucky and then lucky and then lucky. The amount of battles that he has survived and that he has been integral in achieving victory, that it just, he seems as a character that he is basically a droid Jedi.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, honestly, I feel like if you translated his beeps in at least one of the films, he probably says, I have a bad feeling about this.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, I mean, he says basically that, like, you can hear it in the beats.
He's
where
very
he's like,
intuitive.
We shouldn't go there. Like,
and
that's not the right way.
Instructing people like a Jedi, but he's stuck in that little droid body where he just has to roll around. I think that you would see him be far more forceful in this if he had C-3PO's body, where he's, you know, more of a quadruped or whatever, you know, where he's got
a humanoid,
exactly. But he's always like, he's often instructing people, no, don't go that way, go this way, right? That C-3PO is like clear evidence that not all droids have got the Force, because his instincts are all wrong all the time.
Right.
Yeah.
But R2 seems to have intuition into things that he really shouldn't have intuition into, other than he's connected to the Force.
You know, that's really interesting, because of course we learn that that Anakin built C-3PO. Uh-huh. So it would almost make more sense for C-3PO to have the Force, because, you know, he's leaving some kind of imprint on him when he constructed him.
But this is the whole thing of, like, is it a physiological thing where you can measure it in midichlorians or maxichlorians? Or is this something that the Force is all around us, and that, you know, that if you reach out, you can actually sense it. It's in all living things, but droids are interacting with living things all the time. So it's like this whole thing of, like, well, if you remove the midichlorians as the explanation for how you can be tuned into the Force, then it allows R2-D2 to actually be connected to it. But I think the film suggests that he is.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, even at the end of episode 7, when he randomly turns back on after being asleep forever.
Yes.
Like, he very much does seem to. Yeah, that's. Man, that is.
I don't know if anybody said that before, but boom, I win.
And it does with episode 7, because, like, when Luke cuts himself off from the Force, then R2-D2 just shuts off, and, like, maybe he also cut himself off from the Force because of Luke, but.
Exactly.
That would. Make more sense, I guess, even though, because, like, Luke wasn't the only one who he liked. Like, it's not just like, oh, Luke's no longer gonna interact with me, I'm shutting down. Like,
yeah, well, I mean, the excuse that the filmmakers said was that R2 was searching through his memory banks from when he had connected to the Imperial databases all those times that he plugged into different computers. So he was searching through there to find the big part of the star map to find Luke.
But how do you do that when you're shut off?
Huh?
How do you do that when you're shut off, though?
Yeah,
he was in low power mode, according to C-3.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Yeah. Right.
But anyway.
I think that, like, that at least the films hold up better, and he as a character holds up better if you understand that he is connected to the Force, because everything that he does showed, like, it shows why he's able, why he is different from all other droids like him. That's why he survives. It's not just that they keep taking him around. Like, I mean, maybe initially they do because he's, you know, the only one left, but it's like he should have been destroyed, you know, long before. I don't know if, you know, the folks who are writing Star Wars know this, but it's there, it's in the text. Like,
that is really, really fascinating. I love that that theory. That's fantastic.
See, I can say nice things about Star Wars. This is why I get angry about newer ones, because I'm like, I really liked Star Wars.
And just a side note, I don't really get why I feel like the ship that was shooting at theirs could have destroyed the ship faster than just shooting all the little R2 units and then going
for the
main ship.
Were they aiming for the droids?
I don't really know.
For the ship and hitting the droids.
If they were aiming for the ship, they have just the, like, I don't even know, but their luck would have been astonishing if they just happened to shoot every single R2 unit and not hitting the ship.
Yeah. I thought that, I did think that they were trying to hit the R2 units because they were like the ones that would like fix the ship if you hit the ship itself. Then they would then go and try to repair it. So then it's like, well, if you like kill all the mechanics, then you can't fix it.
But I feel like it would have just been faster to just shoot.
They had already hit the ship at least once.
Yeah. Well, I know. Like, just blow the entire ship up. Just Okay. Who's next?
I think we are on to either Watto, if you want to talk about him, or Anakin.
Okay.
Watto is somehow immune to force trickery.
Because he's so greedy, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. No, mind tricks don't work on me, only money. Oh, okay.
I could believe that.
It's a weird little detail to throw in there.
It is a really strange detail.
Because it's like, I thought that the Jedi just, you know, like, were amazingly powerful and could do this to, like, any creature, but apparently... You know,
greed is even more powerful. I think that's the way it works.
I mean, Star Wars, the franchise, has certainly...
has proven this. Yeah. Has proven this. Disney has proven this.
Yes.
Oh, my goodness. Okay, so Anakin...
Yeah.
All right. I know this is not, it's in part a character thing. Anakin in episode one has got some of the worst lines in all of Star Wars. Oh, yes. His dialogue drives me crazy. And I think I've said it before. I don't know if like we were recording when I said it, but I think the line that just bugs me more than any other line in all of Star Wars is when he's actually flying in space for the first time. And then he goes, now this is pod racing, you know? And it's like, you literally were pod racing. Like you are a pod racer. This is not pod racing. Why are you saying that this is pod racing?
Yeah.
Pod racing seemed way more difficult than flying in space.
Yes. It's, oh my goodness, that line is atrocious. It's it's so bad, because if he had said, now this is piloting, then that would be like, oh, okay, because he's always wanted to be a pilot, and pod racing was his way of doing that on Tatooine. Now he's actually being a pilot.
Right.
That would make more sense.
I'll show you. This is how stupid it is. Now this is being pen pals. Like, no, we're not pen pals. This is podcasting. Yes. It's just like, it's literally not the thing you just said it is.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know. He's got that, and I know he's got other lines that drive me crazy.
Are you an angel? That one is.
Yeah.
That one's pretty bad. Are you scared? No, just cold, sir. No, I can tell that you're scared.
Right. Right.
What even, like, how, that one makes very little sense to me, especially because, like, what response is that? Are you scared? No, I'm just cold. Like, is it because, like, what?
If I'm cold, that means I can't be scared, right?
Yeah, like, if someone asks me if I'm scared, I'm not like, oh, no, I'm just shivering because I'm cold.
I know, Anakin, he's a bit special in this film. I mean, like, even when he's piloting for the first time, it was so stupid because it was not consistent with his character, that he's supposed to be this excellent, you know, pod racer, and then he gets into the ship, and then, like, is this how he learned how to pod race? He's like, what's this button do? Whoa! Yeah. Let's try this. Whoa! I'm like, if that's how you learned how to pilot a pod racer, you'd be dead. You just randomly start pushing buttons and then throwing the controls all over the place.
Oh, and he's like, I mean, He has trashed pod racers before.
Yes. But, like, he's literally, like, his life is in danger, and he's like, whoa! Just, like, yes. Half in the time of his life. It makes no sense.
Yeah, and he's like, let's try spinning. That's a cool trick. Right. You're trying to do tricks while you're being shot at.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In that cockpit. Okay, I haven't left the cockpit. Oh my goodness, you.
Like, it's that if he's supposed to be so capable of being tuned into the Force because of his midichlorians are off the charts, but he's got raw, untapped talent and potential, then wouldn't you see discipline and insight within there rather than button mashing? That's all that he's doing. It's like he's a kid trying to play like Super Smash Brothers, and it's just like, bah, wow, this is so much fun. Except it's real life and he might die, and he seems to not even be aware of this. How is he supposed to be the greatest Jedi of all time? Like,
yeah. It's messed up.
although you could look at it as he's just the one who happens to destroy the Sith. He might not be the strongest Jedi.
Yeah,
he could just be someone in the background who's like, oh, you've already got your legs cut off? Well, I'm just going to stab you while you're on the ground and no one can do anything. Like, that could be the prophecy, but that's not what they played out to be in the prequels anyway.
Well, yeah, because I'm not just saying that they could misinterpret it, but they're not misinterpreting that his midichlorians are off the charts.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, so it's just, you would think that we would actually see evidence of that. Like, if I were like Qui-Gon after spending a little bit of time with him, I'd be like, I don't care what your midichlorians are. You're dumb.
Yeah.
You're hopeless. And then we end up meeting Anakin in, you know, episode 2, and, you know, it's a different character. You know, he's not that little kid anymore.
Yeah,
which I think is a line from the movie.
I think so. Yes, you're definitely not that boy I knew on Tatooine.
Yeah. Right. Exactly. In case you didn't catch it.
Actually, I think she actually says, you're still that little boy I knew on Tatooine.
Oh, yeah. I think she says,
which is even creepier.
It's almost like, you know, for viewers who have not seen episode 1 in a while, it's like she needed to hold up, like, the picture and, like, hold it up to his face. It's just like, for you viewers at home, here you go. It's the same character, just in case you missed it. Like, that's what that line is.
Nothing. Absolutely nothing like he did in episode 1. It's so weird. It's like, the sandy blonde haired kid. I guess the sand just got in his hair. That's what colored it before. Now that he's off Tatooine and it's darkened up.
He
likes the new hair color, and that's why he hates sand. He was like, oh, that old hair color.
Just sandblasting his hair the whole time. I don't know. What do you guys think about Anakin once he's a teenager? And
I mean, he seems to be a fairly skilled pilot, I guess, if you want to call it that. He flies that whatever car thing, flying car, at the beginning, which is, you know, a cool sequence. And then he jumps off of it, so he's clearly very reckless.
Uh-huh.
That's about all I got. And he's, crazy obsessed in love with Padme. For, again, no real reason other than, you know, she's really beautiful and reminds me of my mom.
Yeah.
I think that they really needed to show a scene where he's, like, just a phenomenal pilot. Because in episode 4, then Obi-Wan's like, he says to Luke, he's like, oh, your father was the best star pilot in the galaxy. But we never see that. Like, and in episode 3, there is that sequence where, in the very beginning, when they show up, and it's a great sequence, but, like, the worst thing that happens is he gets shot at by missiles, runs his ship into Obi-Wan's, and then shoots two turrets, and they fly in. And it's like, that's...
Crashes the big ship.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, lands it.
But I didn't mind his character. Like, yeah, there's a lot of things where it's like, eh, like the Padme and relationship, and some of the lines that he says, but overall, I don't hate his character as much as everyone else does. And I don't think Hayden Christensen was as bad a choice as people think he was, but
I think a lot of it I think a lot of it has to do with the script, has to do with direction, has to do with editing. I think it's very similar to Jar Jar Binks. I think that there's a lot of misplaced anger. I don't know what he's supposed to do with, you know, some of the lines of dialogue that he's given, or even the direction. And you can't do anything about the way something gets framed, the way something gets edited, that but I mean, even as it's like, I don't have issues with Hayden Christensen, but, or even like his acting choices, I actually don't have issues there. It's just, there's not much to work with, with his character. There's just not a lot of interesting stuff happening. We're told that this is all really interesting and like, you know, oh, the feelings I have, but it's like, okay. So you're a teenage boy who's absolutely obsessed with this girl. Like, wow, that's so rare. Has that ever happened to a teenage boy ever? Really? Do you know what I mean? It's just, it's such a common thing where it's like, well, that doesn't seem particularly, like, it doesn't seem to offer something particularly interesting. Like, unlike what you get with Obi-Wan. Obi-Wan, like, as we were talking about, has got really, really interesting things happening to him that he has to take on Anakin, but he doesn't want to because he didn't really agree with him being taken on in the first place by Qui-Gon. But then Qui-Gon, his own master, is killed. So now he kind of resents him. But then, you know, he doesn't see that Anakin will end up in this place and that he's devastated. Like, that's really interesting to see that character go through that. And Anakin as a character, it's, you know, he desperately, you know, wants his mother and wants to go and rescue her. And I think that's when his character starts becoming interesting. But the whole stuff with Padme, I don't see why we needed to get as much of it on screen as we did.
And it's like in episode 5, Yoda says that Anakin was always looking to the future, that he never had his mind on where he was, but like, I almost feel like that's completely opposite, except for in episode 3, because Anakin just always seems to be in the moment, and that's why he gets so angry and stuff.
You're right.
Until he's like, oh, Padme, you're gonna die of in childbirth? Well, now I need to be focused on the future and preventing only that. But in episode 2, he's always like, he's just always focused on the moment, and really never on what's happening outside of what he's a part of.
I mean, it's really interesting. He doesn't seem to want to be a Jedi like at all, like even in episode 1, then he says, I'm gonna be a Jedi and come back and free the slaves, and it's like, well, that's not really what the Jedi do. So I think you just don't really understand what a Jedi is. And then he, you know, becomes part of the Jedi Order, and then what choice does he have? Because he can't really leave the Jedi Order. So then he's just kind of stuck there, even though he's like, well, I don't care about the Force, I care about Padme. I mean, it is a weird obsession, but he has that, and he is aware of that, so it's frustrating to see him, you know, like, I don't know, because he does say, like, oh, you're tearing me apart, Lisa. Sorry, Padme. but, like, I don't know that she's really tearing him apart. She's really just the only thing that he's focused on. He doesn't seem to have much that's keeping him with the Jedi Order, other than, well, I'm already a part of it, so what can I do?
Right.
Yeah.
I do think that, I mean, Anakin's arc in episode 3 is again, you know, just like everything else in episode three, basically, much better than in episodes two and one, because he, you know, he's trying to take care of his wife, trying to secure her future. He's worried about her, which is something that, you know, everyone who has a loved one has gone through at one point or another, where they've just been like, you know, I will do anything to save that person. And watching that is actually very compelling. Mm-hmm. It's just that you had to buy into the romance in two, and the majority of people did not. They couldn't, right? So then you get into episode three, and it's like, okay, if I buy that, yes, they are really in love and, you know, are meant to be together and whatever, then, yeah, he will do absolutely anything in order to save her. And it is... you do see more of the struggle in him in episode three, where he's, you know, like, well, I don't know, I am a Jedi, but I have to keep that part of my life secret and all that. And then when he's, you know, being tempted by Darth Sidious, Palpatine, and it is actually more compelling than anything you get in episode two, where he seems to just be going with the flow and doesn't have any sort of, he's not really tempted by anyone. He has a little fit on Tatooine. I mean, it's a very serious fit, don't get me wrong, but, you know, like, that's about it. So episode three, like, his character really starts to be a character. But episodes one and two, he's not.
And I also think that, similar to Anakin killing the Tusken Raiders, it was also like, I really wanted to see the Jedi Temple battle, like, between Anakin going in, because he would have grown up and would have been mentored by so many of the people in the Jedi Temple, and he's just going in there and even mentored some of the people in there, and now he's got to, like, go in there and kill them. Like, that would have been really interesting to see. And, like, it's just like, there's no connection there. Like, the scene where he you know, the kid's like, oh, Master Skywalker, there's too many of them. What are we going to do? And he just turns on the lightsaber. Like, it's really emotional because he's just about to kill kids and stuff. But, like, we don't have a connection to these characters that he's killing. So it's sad. But at the same time, it could have been so much more sad if we had actually known those people.
Yes. Yeah, we definitely should have seen, you know, more of Anakin's actual training. Rather than just being, you know, skipping over 10 years in order to get to when he's a teenager. I think that with that sequence, it comes on too quickly after he pledges allegiance to Palpatine, where, okay, yeah, I'll do anything you ask, and then it's like, okay, cool, go to the Jedi Temple and kill all the little kids, and then he does, and it's just like, whoa, that's, like, I would have liked to have seen, like, a little bit of struggle there, but you don't get that. Like, you just see, oh, his eyes are red, all of a sudden he's evil, and will literally do anything. Like, if he had, you know, had some hesitation about it, if he had, you know, like, I don't know, it would have been a kind of cool visual to have him, like, blindfold himself when he went into the temple, like, went in to see the younglings so that he didn't have to see their faces as he struck them down, right? Like, something like that, where he would have to struggle with it, not just be like, okay, yeah, I'm evil, I gotta kill all you kids, like,
Especially because a little bit before that, then, like, he almost tries to take in Palpatine, like, and arrest him, and then, like, Mace Windu tries to kill him, and then he's just all of a sudden, like, now I'm your apprentice. Yeah. And, like, there is definitely some manipulation before that happens, but, like, he still just, like, goes from wanting to arrest Palpatine to suddenly he's a Sith now.
I think if you're looking at this as a trilogy, then if you combined what happens in episodes one and two, and you combine that into one film, where you find young Anakin and then he becomes a teenager who's a bit reckless by the end of it. And you're like, you have two different actors, but you do that. And then, you know, episode two ends with him pledging himself to Palpatine. And then you're waiting for episode three going, whoa. So the Jedi don't know that this has happened. And, you know, like, that would have made episode, it would have been a great ending to episode two. And then it would have been, there would have been so much anticipation for episode three. And I think it would have made episode three so much better, because that's where it gets really, really interesting. But then there's not enough of all of the stuff that's going on there.
Yeah, I mean, that would that would have been amazing, because then episode two would be really, really, really well paired with Empire Strikes Back. Exactly. Where at the end of that, then you get the, you know, whole, like, join me and we'll rule the galaxy together.
That's right.
If you get that moment again in episode two, then you're going like, oh man, this is where it actually happened.
Exactly.
where the dark side did win, where, you know, you're seeing the difference between Luke and Anakin.
That's what episode two should have been, is it should have been like Empire, where you get that ending and you're going, well, that's deeply unsettling, right? With that, and then where you're hoping for something by episode three that, you know, the good guys are going to come back, but you've got fear that maybe it won't happen.
Instead, you've got episode two ending with Anakin and Padme are married now.
I know. Again, I understand that the chances of any Hollywood producer ever watching this happens to be like probably zero. But if there is a Hollywood producer who is ever watching this, then I can punch up scripts. I'm good at this kind of stuff. Hire me.
I would say that about all three of us, honestly.
Like, we'll collaborate, all three of us, as a team.
Only pay us one salary and we'll still be fine.
Fine with that. I don't think the Writers Guild will accept that, but
no.
Shh, under the table. Okay, so we've got Anakin. Let's move on. Who's next?
Shmi.
Which one's like that? I don't think we. It's Anakin's mom.
That's Anakin's mom. She gave birth to a child because of the Force.
Right.
I just really wanted to point that out. Like, it's like, where did he come from? There was no father. I don't know.
I know.
Popped out one day. Okay. Yeah.
She's Star Wars Mary, Virgin Mary. I mean.
Yeah. I mean, there is this whole, you know, theory that, that Palpatine and Darth Plagueis, who was presumably Palpatine's master, then the two of them were working to try to figure out how to manipulate the Force in order to maintain life, and what they ended up doing was creating life. So they actually created Anakin, which is why there's such a huge concentration of the Force and everything, and why Anakin was so easily turned to the dark side. So that's, I think, a really, really compelling theory. And and I would, you know, I'd like to believe it. It's I don't see anything in the films that disproves it, but it would be kind of nice to get just a little bit more of that. And I think, honestly, like, episode one would have been much better. I agree with combining episodes one and two, but if you had had, like, episode one start out with Darth Plagueis and, you know, and Darth Sidious, maybe you don't even have to see Sidious's face, but the two of them, you know, working with the Force, like, I don't know, they're chanting or something, right? Like, in order to make something happen, and then you smash cut to, you know, Anakin being born. And then, you know, like, just do, like, a little bit of, like, a montage, sort of, to show Anakin's early years. But George Lucas seems to be very, very opposed to those kinds of time jumps.
I know.
He hasn't done it in any of his films.
Right. That's why I know that, like, my idea of, like, episodes one and two getting combined together, that, like, well, that's not Star Wars. And you could, that's a fair argument, because he doesn't do those time jumps. You don't get those montages. You don't get a time jump, even though you're like, yeah, but it could be really useful.
Yeah, absolutely. And
I honestly don't even think it needs to be Plagueis who is with Sidious. Like, it could have been young Count Dooku and Palpatine, because it would have been really interesting if Count Dooku had a part of creating Anakin, and then he fights him later.
Yeah.
And then it ends up being Palpatine who joins forces with him, because then you could have, you know, maybe something interesting about Count Dooku in the prequels, where he could have been like, well, I don't really like you because now you're more powerful than me, and Palpatine's kind of interested in bringing you to our side, and I don't want that. And then it could have, like, it could just, it would just, I think, been more interesting, because
that is, that's a Count hilarious thing. Yeah.
Like, Count Dooku would have had, like, something interesting about him.
Right. Yeah. There would have been something interesting about him. And Anakin's in this position of like, ah, my dads are fighting over me. Yeah. I don't know which one to choose.
Yeah.
They're asking me to testify in court. And I don't know. I just love them both so much.
Yeah. Yeah. I really do feel like Count Dooku and Christopher Lee are wasted in those films.
Yeah. Like, we need a Count Dooku solo movie, because like, he is one of the most interesting, he could be the most interesting character in Star Wars. He was trained by Yoda, then goes to the dark side and trains under the Emperor. Like, that is so cool.
Yeah.
And, yeah, and he trains Qui-Gon.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. It's true. That would be really interesting to see, like, a three-act structure dealing with that, you know? Trained by Yoda, Act 1, training Qui-Gon, Act 2, and trained by Sidious, Act 3.
Yeah.
All right, Hollywood, Disney, get on it.
Yeah.
Okay, so who do we have next, then?
I don't know who's next.
I feel like that's about it for episode one, right?
Well, there's Darth Maul.
Right, we haven't talked about
that. Right.
We kind of talked about him before. I forget when we talked about him.
But... that was in the first Star Wars podcast that I was a part
of. That's right.
Except for with this, I do have something to say about him for episode one, and that's that he's basically Boba Fett and Captain Phasma done right, because he looks cool and does something.
Yeah.
Yes. I mean, I still don't think that he's done right.
I don't think that he's
he's done better than Phasma for sure.
Like, he doesn't have a characterization really, but at least he does something. Like, it's not just that he looks cool, it's that he looks cool but he's also like doing at least something. And because he takes out the double-bladed lightsaber, he kills Qui-Gon. Like, he actually does stuff, whereas Boba Fett and Captain Phasma do nothing.
Right.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, it's... I guess I'd just like to get a little bit more dialogue from Darth Maul. That's the one thing.
Any dialogue?
He has one line, I think.
What does he say?
He says, I think he says, well, two things technically. One of them is yes, my master, but he just says yes, master, I think. I don't know. It's basically Darth Vader's line from episode 5 when he says yes, my master, or whatever. But anyway, then there's the line, at last we will reveal ourselves to the Jedi, at last we will have our revenge.
Yeah.
Okay.
And that's pretty much the only thing he says, I think.
Yeah. Yeah. Which, yeah, I mean, I want to get more dialogue from him. How about he actually tells the Jedi, like, yes, I'm a Sith, and, you know, we're back.
Right.
To, like, really freak them out, to really get their plan in motion, rather than just having an entire fight sequence where he doesn't say a word. Like, two fight sequences where he doesn't say a word.
Yeah, and, it's... go ahead, Luke.
Okay, I think that, like, okay, this is one of my... one of the things that frustrates me so much with the prequels is, like, there's so many Sith characters, but, like, whatever happened to the rule of two that they talk about in the end of episode one? Because then there's Count Dooku. And then if you go into the Clone Wars TV series, both of them, there's Asajj Ventress. And then there's also General Grievous. And it's like, but what happened to the rule of two?
Yeah.
For one thing, I, again, won't watch the series, the animated series. Yeah. I don't know who that Ventress person is.
She's in the first Clone Wars series back in 2003. She
That's right.
Two red lightsabers, and then she has a really good fight scene with Anakin.
Yeah.
Right.
I didn't watch the show, but I've seen that.
Yeah.
Yeah. And yeah. So that, I mean, it's interesting though, because yes, there's the rule of two, but Count Dooku, like, he is aligned with Darth Sidious, but he kind of seems like he's not for part of episode two.
Yeah.
You know, like, he says, like, oh yeah, there's somebody in the, at the top of the whatever, Senate who's like really big in the Senate, and he's a Dark Lord and he already has control. Like, why would he say that? Like, it's the exact opposite of what I'm saying with Darth Maul, where, like, Darth Maul just needed to say, yes, there are Sith. Count Dooku, like, just needed to say that. He didn't need to say, like, by the way, you know the entire Senate that you're a part of? Well, turns out that is under our control.
Yeah.
He doesn't say our control. He says, there's a powerful Sith who's in charge of it. He's like, so are you not with him then? But then you see him with him at the end of the movie. I don't know.
Yeah.
I mean, I guess it's like kind of pulling strings, but to make Dooku seem like he's not, I don't know. It's weird.
And that reminds me of another thing. In the Clone Wars TV series, which is canon, but they basically say that Count Dooku is responsible for the death of Master Sifo Dyas, the guy who's the head council member of the Jedi. Because when Obi-Wan shows up on Kamino and he's like, and the Kamino people are like, they say like, oh yeah, we made this deal with Master Sifo Dyas. And then Obi-Wan's like, Master Sifo Dyas, he's not been like the Grand Master of the Jedi for like 10 years. He's been dead for 10 years. So I think that that's also really interesting that Count Dooku is the one responsible for his death. And I also think that'd be great to have in a Count Dooku solo movie, but.
Yeah. Yeah. There's a lot there. That could be explored.
Yeah.
Or at least a book. Like, anything more Count Dooku, I just want to see, like, before episode one.
Yeah.
Or before episode two, I guess.
Yeah. Hmm. Yeah. It's, I mean, he also goes by the name Darth Tyrannus.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which is, like, it's a really cool name, and yet is never used. Everybody always just refers to him as Count Dooku. Which I think is really kind of sad.
Yeah.
That's the only thing I had to say there. Like, I don't know. Like, oh, hey, Count. One Sith.
Yeah. It's interesting that, like, they have counts in the Star Wars universe.
Yeah.
Like, this weird European aristocratic title that I don't exactly know how you get to become a count. But
what is he the count of?
Yeah, that's what I was just gonna say. Because, like,
how is he still a count after he's been like, missing for so many? Yeah,
when he was a Jedi, was he a count, or did he just become a count when he became a Sith? Or, like, I don't even know. It's just like, you could also explore that in a solo movie or book.
Who's next?
All right, we got Jango Fett.
We haven't talked about Jango yet.
Ah, he does more stuff than Boba Fett.
That's for
he does.
And he has a way cooler death.
Yeah.
His head gets chopped off.
Yeah. And
way cooler than just falling into the Sarlacc pit.
Yeah. By a blind Han Solo.
Right. Yeah.
And he kills a Jedi.
Yeah, and he's the source, the original for the clones.
Yeah.
Which is really interesting. Again, I wish that they didn't redub his voice over Boba Fett in episodes 5 and 6. I guess maybe just 5. Anyway, but yeah, Jango is like a really cool character, and you actually get to see like, oh, this is why the Fetts are, you know, so well known.
Yeah.
This is a really awesome, crazy bounty hunter.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Now I'm. It's been a long time since I've seen episode 2, but do you get an explanation of why he agrees to become the source of these clones?
I don't think so.
I think it was primarily just money. Like,
okay.
That's at least what he says. Mm-hmm. But he does say, "I was hired by a man named Tyrannus."
Yeah.
So he was hired by Count Dooku.
Right.
But outside of that, that's about it.
Because I think the most interesting part of the character for me is like that choice. If you think about this, I'm not trying to be weird here, but this is going to go in a slightly weird direction. You guys don't have to answer this question, but just consider it. Would you ever donate to a sperm bank? Where then you could potentially have your kid out there in the world and you have no idea who it is. Like, I mean, I don't know how anybody donates to a sperm bank because that seems really strange to me. Like, how do you have, like, really your own child who's out there and you just have no idea who it is? The idea of fathering someone, I mean, fathering a child is for any man who does have children, like, they will point to that as the most significant thing they've done within this life. Like, almost any father will point to that and say, that's the most important thing I did, is I created this life or these lives. So I'm like, it's such a fascinating thing, but it feels like it doesn't get explored in the least. That's why I was asking you, like, was there anything about this? Because more than him just being cool and capable, it's like, all right, that's fine, but how would you feel like if somebody asked me to father a child that I'm not going to have any say over? Then I'd be like, ooh, I don't know. If somebody's like, how about you father like thousands of kids, like they're all, I'd be like, can I have the weekend to think on this?
And they're all going to be in the military without choice,
right? Like, wouldn't you feel some, you know, sense of being complicit in anything they do, that if they kill somebody, it's like, well, but you had a hand in that because you know that they're weaponizing your own DNA. Don't these seem good questions?
They do. Yeah, absolutely. He did have, from what I recall, he had but one request, which was to have one unaltered clone.
Yeah.
Which was, of course, Boba Fett.
Yeah.
So, like, I agree with absolutely everything that you're saying, that it's a really strange choice. But I guess, like, if he really that desperately wanted to have his own son, like...
Is it really that hard to find a woman in that galaxy?
And you're a bounty hunter? Like, I'm
right. He's already cool. And, he's got swagger. Yeah. I'm sure he could have found there a lady at some kind of like cantina somewhere.
Maybe he was upset by the mixed Gen X, and he's like, no, I want the son to be exactly me.
That's so weird.
He's like, I don't want there to be anybody else in this kid. It's just me.
The level of like self-love you would have, just pure me. I'm perfect.
Yeah.
There was actually a video game called Star Wars Bounty Hunter that it was a long time ago. I played it, but I don't really remember like any of the story, but it's about Jango Fett. And I want to play it again now just to see if they explain any of this, because it is a lot about, like, I think all of it is before episode 2, so it would probably explain all of this. And I'm interested to play it, like, because I want to play it again now just because of this conversation, because, like...
Yeah.
Yeah.
No.
Yeah. The other video game that I'd like to bring up is Star Wars Battlefront 2, where they have the campaign mode. You're following 501st Army, like the clone army, but the 501st Division. And one of their missions is to go to Kamino, the cloning facility, and destroy all the original samples, so that they can't make any counter clones, and that all future clones will be done from a wider base, so that you won't have, you know, all identical stormtroopers. So that I think is a good workaround for why, you know, the stormtroopers sound different and everything.
Yeah, right.
In episodes 4, 5, and 6. I mean, also, like, the clones have a shorter lifespan anyway, so like most of them would have died off before episode 4.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, there's all of these interesting, like, I don't think that they're particularly interesting, but all of these plot elements that fans want and that Lucasfilm seems to always be trying to, like, tie in. Like, when people say, like, oh, well, we need to know this connection, or we don't need to know all of that. But I'm just like, but if we're just, like, from a character standpoint, then... It's you look at somebody like Jango Fett, and I'm just like, I feel like George Lucas just doesn't know what's interesting.
Right.
Like, he doesn't know what questions or what, and when I say questions, what I really mean is what themes to explore. It's like, you just did something so interesting. You've got this crazy, cool, super capable bounty hunter who is now the source of all of these clones. Don't you think that's interesting and that you should explore that a little bit? Like, yeah, the clones are cool, and then how they end up getting used is interesting. But the whole question of you as a person, how do you come to that decision, and how does somebody convince you of that, and how do you resolve ethical issues that come alongside with that? It just seems like stuff that it doesn't even have to be a really long sequence, but just a scene where you somehow get into it to some degree. You point to it at the very least.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's like one of the most interesting points that I think belated media makes with their prequel trilogy, you know, What If It Were Good series, is this idea of, like, speaking to George Lucas and saying, hey, familiarity is, you know, appropriate for sequels or even prequels, but it doesn't have to be characters. It's about familiar themes.
Yeah.
And that's something that George Lucas didn't seem to understand, where he was like, oh yeah, let's make sure to put R2-D2 and C-3PO and Obi-Wan and Anakin and, you know, everybody who we know from the original trilogy that would have been alive, let's put all of them in these other films.
Right.
It's like, well, I don't know that that's really necessary. I mean, he also says that, you know, like, what if Yoda was, like, not really seen for, like, the majority of any of the films, and, you know, he's just always talked about and whispered about because he's this, you know, hugely important Jedi who's so knowledgeable with the Force that, you know, he's just, like, on this whole other level sort of thing. And it's like, well, yeah, that would actually be really awesome.
Yeah.
Also why I think that Yoda shouldn't have fought Count Dooku in episode 2, and that it should have been Mace Windu. Because I think it would have been so much more interesting to see Yoda fight for the first time against the Emperor.
Yeah. So let's get into that then.
Before we get into that, can I just finish off on this thing with Jango Fett?
Yep.
Yeah.
So Tyler, what you're saying makes so much sense. Or I guess, sorry, you've said it. I don't know how many times. What's the name of the YouTube page?
Belated Media.
Belated Media. So, and it is a YouTube channel, correct?
Yeah.
Okay. So that it should be familiar themes. Well, if you look at the original trilogy, one of the, I would say the most important theme, even more so than good versus evil, is fatherhood. It's
right.
Abandoning your children, being a bad father, and then the legacy that leaves for the next generation, for your children, for Luke and Leia. And that is the thing that is just hanging over that entire thing of, you know, Vader, you know, has basically killed Anakin, and he's killed him as a father and as a you know, some kind of influence over his children's lives. And so I'm saying that theme is right there. The potential for it is there with Jango Fett and the clones of what kind of a father are you to then create these things and then abandon them. And then you just leave them to be influenced by whoever is going to then control them. That's a very similar theme to what you get with Vader and his children.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's, you know, I mean, that really just makes me think that there is a huge missed opportunity by saying that Anakin had no father. There could have been a lot of really interesting stuff there.
Well, I really like that idea that it was like the Sith that somehow generated that. Cause I think that actually makes like that fits really well with the things that get explored.
Yeah. Yeah.
Luke, are you still okay? Do you need to go?
I've got a little bit more time left, but, yeah, I'm going to have to go pretty soon because I'm dog-sitting for someone.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Okay. We haven't talked about... we were just starting in on Yoda.
Yeah. You know, one of the bonus features for episode two, then George Lucas talks about... because they're trying to redesign Yoda to make him digitally. Because in episode two, that was the first time that he was done digitally. They've since gone back and done him digitally in episode one as well. Which is terribly sad. He was like, let's see. Yeah. What should his fighting style be? You know, I think he should be like really hopping around a lot. And, you know, I guess I kind of think of his model as being sort of, you know, a cross between Miss Piggy and Kermit the Frog. And I'm just like, wait, what?
Wait, did George Lucas say this?
Yes, he did.
Oh, so Yoda is literally, like, those are his parents, Kermit the Frog and Miss Piggy.
Yes.
Okay. There's that exploration of the theme of parenthood. What happens if you have a frog and a pig who then have a child together? It'd be a good result. It'd be pretty brilliant.
Yeah, it's so weird. I think that like Yoda is a puppet. I'm sorry, but Yoda is a puppet. And really, like, I understand the decision to move to digital, especially when you want to have, you know, Yoda finally wield a lightsaber and jump around and fight Count Dooku. But I don't know. I think that, again, like, the most interesting part even of that battle is when he, you know, absorbs the lightning from Count Dooku and just, like, dissipates it. He just has nothing afterward. And it's like, whoa! That I would say is like the only really cool thing that you get from Yoda in episodes 1, 2, and 3. Like, you know, he has fun moments, but that's the only like moment where you're like, oh, that really added something to his character, you know?
Yeah.
And I think we could have got that though if he had just fought Palpatine in episode 3 instead of just doing
I think
it
you're right on
two.
That. I really do. I like that point. I think that he did get overused. And I think, Tyler, you're the one who was saying that, where you could make the argument that if we didn't see him a whole bunch, or was that you, Luke, who was saying that?
That was Tyler.
Okay. That
I mean, if I stole that from Belated Media.
But right. That if you didn't if you didn't see him for much of it, but he's just kind of hanging over the entire film. Like, I think it's that he is underused because he is overly present on screen.
Yeah.
You know?
And I think that, like, especially if, like, I think if Mace Windu went to fight Count Dooku in episode 2, then I think it would have been a lot more interesting as well in episode 3 when he goes to confront the Emperor, because now we've seen what he can do. And now it's like, oh, wow, like, the Emperor, we're seeing the Emperor fight for the first time, and we're, like, worried to see what he can do, because we've already seen him use lightning before. But now we've also seen what Mace Windu can do, and he poses an equal threat almost to the Emperor. So I think it would have been like when he goes to arrest him, then there would be so much anticipation for that fight. And then after seeing Yoda fight him, then there would be just even more anticipation. And I think it would have just been really great if they did that.
Yeah. Yeah. Mace Windu is an incredible character.
How much more time do you have, Luke? Approximately
about 10 minutes.
Okay, so we'll do this in less than 10. we'll try at least. So Mace Windu, go ahead, Tyler.
I mean, played by Samuel L. Jackson, and you know, he has a purple lightsaber, which you know, Sam L. Jackson actually specifically requested.
I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm. He was like, I want something to make me stand out from all the others. And he was like, okay, here's a purple lightsaber. I'm like, what the?
because I think it was either George Lucas or Samuel. I think Samuel L. Jackson was saying this, how he was like, oh, I want a purple light, or I want a different colored lightsaber. And George Lucas was like, oh, okay, I don't know if we'll do that. But then eventually he was just like, oh, hey, Mace Windu, come in, come see this. And then he came into the, like, to the room where they were editing and all that. And then he saw the lightsaber and he was like, oh my gosh, I actually got a purple lightsaber. This is so awesome.
That's cool.
Yeah. So Sam L. Jackson did also have one request, which was that he did not want to go out like a female dog. He was like, you can't do me that way. Like, you can't let me go out that way. I got to have a really, really awesome death. And I honestly think that George Lucas failed there. Mace Windu had his hand chopped off and then was shocked by lightning out of window. And you don't even really see him die.
Yeah, it almost looks like he disappears in the robes. Like, it just kind of almost looks like the robes are the only thing that's floating away after he's thrown out the window. And I'm like,
yeah,
was he intended to still be there? Or, like, is it just the robes and he disappeared like Obi-Wan and Yoda did? Like, I don't get that there. Like,
yeah, it's a bit of a sad death for a character who seems like so epic. I mean, you get Sam L. Jackson in episode 1 and it's like, he didn't do anything, but it's still like, I want him to do something. Mm-hmm. And he comes in episode 2 and you're like, oh, cool. And he is actually wielding a lightsaber and, you know, knocking down droids left and right. And then he comes back in episode 3 and you're like, yeah, he's finally going to get his moment. And he doesn't really do too much. So,
yeah. But is that because Mace Windu, we think, is super cool as a character, or because we think that Samuel L. Jackson is super cool as an actor and that he's played so many cool characters? I really feel like it's an actor thing. I don't feel like I think Mace Windu gets overemphasized as being this super cool Jedi when it's really, it's like, yeah, well, you're getting like legitimately one of the coolest actors that you can get. Like, he plays cool guys all the time. Like, he's such a charismatic actor. He's so charming. And then to see him do this role where he's, you know, he's in so many of his films, he's shouting, right? He's just losing it, Samuel L. Jackson. And then when you see him and he's all calm and he's cool, then you're like, whoa, but we know that this dude can lose it. And it's like, but we don't know that about Mace Windu. We know that about Samuel L. Jackson.
Yeah.
And then we're reading all this stuff into Mace Windu, where it's like, oh, don't get Mace Windu angry because he's going to lose. And it's like, do you mean that? Or are you talking about like Pulp Fiction?
Right. Yeah.
Although I do want to see. Sorry, you can go ahead.
I was just gonna say, like, I mean, they do have, you know, the line about like Mace Windu being like the greatest with a lightsaber. So you do get like some background of, oh, he's a really cool fighter. But yeah, I think that in terms of like, yeah, the actual films, and it's all Samuel Jackson.
Yeah,
it is. Like,
I want to know Mace Windu's backstory though. Like we don't really know anything about him other than that he's like this great Jedi, but like I want to know like how he became such a great Jedi, because like we don't really know that,
right? Yeah.
So I think we should quickly maybe try to talk about General Grievous then.
Yeah, I hate General Grievous. He's
I think it again goes back to what Nathan was saying, where George Lucas doesn't know what the interesting part of the story is. You've got a cyborg, right? Like, he's half droid, half organic. Like, what the? That is awesome. I want to see, like, you know, more about him. But all he does is walk around all hunched over and cough and then wields four lightsabers, which is cool. But it's like, what if he's, like, half, like, organic, then he should be able to, you know, use the Force, unless we are going with, you know, that droids can use the Force too.
Yeah.
In which case, like, even cooler, he should be totally awesome. And he only gets one fight scene. And I think this also goes back to your point, Luke, of there are too many, you know, Sith in the original trilogy. In episodes 4, 5, and 6, you had, you know, two villains. That's it. You had Vader and the Emperor. And it was really, really, like, all three stories were about facing off against those two who controlled the entire galaxy. Then you get into episodes 1, 2, and 3, and it's like, oh, yeah, you got this guy, and he got chopped in half. And then you got this guy, and, you know, he got his head chopped off. And then you've got Grievous, who dies in the same movie as the last guy.
Yeah. And, like, okay, the most interesting thing about General Grievous is in the 2003 animated series that came before the new Clone Wars TV series. Because in that one, like, basically General Grievous is just to be intimidating, because he kills Jedi and collects their lightsaber.
Right.
And he's intimidating in that series, because, like, we see this group of Jedi, and they're all, like, terrified of when he's going to attack. And some of them are sweating and they're beaten down. And then General Grievous shows up and kills almost all of them. And it's like, yes, this is something that I wanted to see. But then in episode 3, he's just constantly running away for all the time. And it's like, he's not even a strategist. Why is he a general? That. Yeah.
Like, they literally have a line where it's like, Grievous will run and hide as he always does. And you're just like, wait, what? Like, this is a really cool villain? I don't think so.
Yeah, Luke, that sounds so much better. He sounds like he is a Jedi serial killer who, like, takes their lightsabers as trophies, as a trophy from a kill. Like,
which he shows that he's been collecting lightsabers in episode 3, but you don't get to see him actually collect any lightsabers.
Right.
And imagine in, like, episode 3, we just get to see Obi-Wan and Anakin at the very beginning. They're running through the hallways and stuff, and General Grievous comes flying out of nowhere and just tears them apart, pretty much, and they're terrified and just,
or
like,
even, like, Grievous comes through a doorway while fighting a couple of other Jedi.
Yeah.
And Anakin and Obi-Wan see these other Jedi get struck down, and then they have to, you know, kind of share a look and be like, I guess it's our turn.
And I would love to see them, like, have such a difficult time taking down Grievous, like, because I think that would have been amazing. And then you could have had them be in the ship and almost make a horror movie out of it until they save the Emperor.
Right.
Palpatine. Yeah. Because that would have been, I think that would have been awesome.
Yeah.
Here's the thing. Combine all three Sith into one character, and, you know, you can build a pretty awesome connective story, right? Like, Darth Maul gets chopped in half, and let's say that he's not dead. He didn't fall in a pit. He just got chopped in half, and somehow they were able to, you know, give him robotic legs. Then, in episode 2, he instead of you know, Count Dooku, faces off against Mace Windu, because that is more compelling, right? And you know, he gets his arms chopped off or whatever. Then he comes back in episode 3 as General Grievous, yeah, where he's, you know, a cyborg. Yep. That would be so cool.
That'd be amazing. That'd be great.
One character. Yeah. It doesn't need to be three separate characters.
Mm-hmm.
And without this podcast shorter too.
And without the pit, then we would have also seen him collect Qui-Gon's lightsaber after killing him, and then you know you could see Obi-Wan see his lightsaber and be like, "Oh my goodness,
because then it Qui-Gon's would have had lightsaber? An emotional impact."
Yeah.
Rather than these things that, like, we have no association with them.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh.
So many missed opportunities.
So many. If you could invent a time machine, go back and make Star Wars prequels good.
Yeah.
That's what I'd do with it. It'd be such a weird, specific thing to do.
Start a GoFundMe.
Are we done then? Because I know, Luke, you've got to go, and we've been going for a long time here.
Yep.
Yeah.
So we basically covered everybody?
I think so.
Yeah, pretty much.
Okay. Then we'll say that we're good, and we're going to do this again with episodes 7 and 8. Is that right?
Yes. And then I think we'll do an extra one on Solo and Rogue One if we
feel
like it. Or we might combine those two into one. We'll see how long. Sure. The 7 and 8 one goes. I would just like to once again thank our sponsor, Maxi Chlorian.
The most absorbent of all Chlorians.
Elevate all your right, video to the next level.
All right. I hope you enjoyed the podcast. We'll see you next time. Bye.
Bye.
Hey.
Ignore the bell, people. We're going to keep going. We're still ignoring it. Don't worry. I don't know what that... I think that's the fire drill. All right. We're going to go home. Yeah, all right. We're done.